Hello, and welcome to the presentation of my thesis entitled Towards a Better Understanding of Novel Education Technologies and the Impact of Feedback in Higher Learning, a Behavioral and Electrophysiological Approach. So this thesis was written in the context of the European TEMI project, and this project had the general objective of designing and implementing new technologies for musical learning together with the evaluation of its pedagogical effectiveness. So using the violin as a case of study, the objective of this thesis has been devoted to the better world. Also, an important part of this thesis was developed in collaboration with the Brain Lab of the UB Neuroscience Institute. So we could begin talking in the introduction about the motivations that have led to the development of this thesis, followed by a brief summary of the state of the art. And we have divided the thesis into two parts, one dedicated to the processes of learning movement and generating a good sound on the violin, composed of two experiments, and another one related to intonation processes. And finally, we will talk about the conclusions. So the first thing we have to ask ourselves is, in what way can technologies help us improve learning processes? This question, although it seems simple, says many more details that we will review through the presentation. An answer can be found by studying, for example, the influence that the stopwatch had to allow elite athletes to track their records and allow them to recognize if they were improving or worsening their records in an objective way. This is something very important because in this particular example, the measure of time is an important variable for the athlete. However, what measurements are important to the musician? A musician needs to be aware of his rhythm, his intonation, posture, sound quality, expressiveness. And given the standards and levels of demand that are usually demanded in music schools, it is not surprising the number of frustrated students who end up abandoning their musical studies. So, like the stopwatch for the athlete, music technologies, including some such as those developed in the course of the TEMI project for the violin, allow us to measure and evaluate information related to aspects of musical performance that could be relevant for students. The important thing is that for the first time, they could help us to obtain scientific evaluations about motor activities that were previously evaluated only by subjective means. For example, Weather and Williamson found that an inappropriate stage entrance or negative facial reaction after an error tended to cause a large drop in the quality adjustments of a piece. We know that evaluations are subject to strong subjective biases on the part of instructors, as was well exemplified very well by the now classic work of Goldin and Roos, where they found how blind auditions increased the possibility of women being recruited into orchestras. And finally, music technologies can also help us to learn about the cognitive process of music learning, and in turn, to better evaluate the different methods and pedagogies of music learning that already exist. So, the scientific literature of motor learning has always used music as an example of the incredible potential that human capacities have. However, technological limitations have always tended to reduce the field of study to very simple and not very ecological tasks. So one of the main objectives of this thesis is not only to show how music technologies, but also ICT technologies in general, are an indispensable tool to advance knowledge in areas such as neuroscience, psychology, and pedagogy, and they are already being used, but also to show how the correct design and implementation of these technologies, especially those devoted to educational purposes, completely depend on these disciplines for their correct design and evaluation. At the same time, this opens important bridges for the development of collaborations between academic institutions. Part of this thesis is a product of this. So one of the particular objectives of this thesis was to develop a methodological framework for doing research with educational music technologies. In the second chapter of this thesis, we offer a brief description of the different psychological paradigms that have been used to study motor learning and performance. We also offer a brief description of how the type of feedback, but also the type of the task, can influence learning, like ballistic movements, which are related to inverse models and reward errors, and continuous movements related to forward models and sensory prediction errors. So, using the violin as a case of study, another one of the main objectives of this thesis was to find features that could help us to distinguish the expert performance from the beginner performance. So one of the most difficult tasks a beginner student has to deal with when starting to play the violin is generating a good sound with it. But what is exactly what characterizes a good sound? That's a particular question that can be answered using DSP techniques. Posture and movement are also an important part of violin performance, not only to avoid injuries, but also for the generation of a good sound. We will see how through the use of the motion capture technologies, we can find features that allow us to distinguish the expert motion from the beginner motion. And finally, by measuring the electrophysiological activity of beginners and experts, we can also find features that can allow us to characterize the expert performance. So now, the next step is to explore how the use of those features could allow us to track the learning process of participants during violin lessons by comparing how beginners' results approach those of experts through the different attempts. At the same time, another one of the main objectives of this thesis is also to evaluate the effects of feedback technologies during the process of learning. The same technology that measures the feature and allows us to track learning is delivered as feedback to the participant. And finally, our last objective was to use music technologies to study the neurophysiological correlates of learning, error monitoring, and error correction. So as we said before, we have divided the thesis into two different parts. In the first part of the thesis, we have explored finding features to characterize the sound quality and bowel motion of beginners and experts. This is what we did in our first experiment, using EEG features such as EEG power spectral density and sound quality descriptors. And in the second experiment of this part, where we incorporated optical motion capture technologies to find kinematic descriptors. In the second part of this thesis, we explored intonation in the violin. In our first experiment, we explored the effects of feedback in a pitch matching task. While in the second experiment, we explore the EEG correlates of error monitoring in the expert performance through the use of ERP and ERSP techniques. So let's start with the first part of our thesis, sound and motion in the violin. So in this part of the thesis, we asked ourselves two major questions. Can multimodal data acquired from beginners and experts through both audio and motion capture technologies be used to characterize and generalize the expert performance? And if that is the case, can we improve instrumental learning by offering feedback on those characterizations? We can find some of the most recent attempts at educational technologies for the violin in the iMaestro project, where motion capture technologies were designed with sensors to be able to track the movement of the bow of the participants. In the same vein, we have the work of Schoenderwald, where they have also used a mixture of motion capture technology using both optical motion capture and sensor. The work of Ambacusis, related in the context of the Termi project, represents an alternative that works only through optical motion capture using the Kinect and does not use any type of body sensor. And it's the one that we are going to use in our experiments. One of the most interesting uses of this technology for pedagogical uses is by comparing the performance of experts and beginners and try to find patterns. There is, however, a very simple variable with which many violin pedagogues agree that it's always important in the first steps with the violin, and that it can be measured very easily with this type of technology. It is straight bowing. When a participant moves the bow through the violin, it is very important for the generation of a correct sound that remains perpendicular to the strings through the course. Based on this, Linden et al. Designed a jacket equipped with sensors that vibrates every time the participant deviates from the straight trajectory of the bow. They were also the first to try to experimentally evaluate the effectiveness of this technology with real violin students during 6 weeks of training. However, the experiment has a few limitations. There were only 4 participants per group. Playing the bow straight by itself might not be the best indicator of improvement in performance. And finally, participants repeated 5 different exercises. Some of them involved learning rhythmic movements, which could have located the participant attentions on other variables. So one of the simplest exercises that we consider to evaluate violin techniques in the first steps of learning will be the full bow exercise. Here, we can see an example. So in this exercise, the participant not only has to keep the bow straight while playing, but also the sound it generates has to be as stable as possible, both dynamically and in pitch. Also, in order to measure the sound quality, one approach could be to measure recordings from the participants generating sounds with the violin, asking a group of experts their opinion, for example, the quality of the sound, if it is good or if it is bad, while at the same time in parallel using Sensia, for example, to extract different audio features from each one of the sounds to finally correlate or classify, in this case, the subjective opinions of the experts with the audio features extracted from the recordings. This is the approach that Romani et al. Followed. With those descriptors found, the court company developed an app called the Good Sound Tune, which allows the participant to visualize in real time through descriptors the quality of the sound that they are generating with this instrument. In the context of the TERMI project, and using the same type of approach, we can find the work of Giraldo et al., who designed a similar technology. However, the samples evaluated by the experts were previously produced by another expert. There is also another approach that is also complementary and consists in recording the samples directly from beginners and experts, extract their features, and finding which features allow us to distinguish between them. This is the approach we are using in this part of the thesis. So in the first experiment, evaluation of a sound quality visual feedback system for goal learning technique environment beginners and EEG study, we tracked with sound descriptors and EEG activity the process of learning full bow exercise in complete violent beginners. This experiment can be considered a pilot experiment of the second one, and for time reasons, we will go directly to talk about the second experiment called real-time sound and motion feedback for violent bow technique, a controlled randomized trial, in which we evaluated the improvement of the performance of participants based on both descriptors, kinematics like straight bowing, and sound quality descriptors as previously mentioned. So, here we can see we have used the Kinect, the system designed by Bamba Acoustics to capture the movement of the bow through the Kinect camera. Here we can see the visualization that the participant received and all the different types of features that could be extracted from the performance almost as if they were looking themselves in a mirror. We also used the system designed by Giraldo to evaluate the quality of the sounds that the different participants. So in this experiment, 57 right-handed participants participated in the experiment. 15 of them were expert violinists, and the rest were people who had never played the violin before. 29 were sent to the feedback group and 28 to the control. So all the beginners participants before starting the experiment received a basic class on how to hold the violin and learn the basics to be able to generate sound with the instrument. They received instructions from a 10-minute YouTube video. Once they saw the video, they entered in the baseline phase, which was followed by an acquisition phase composed by three different conditions and a transfer phase, which was the same as the baseline. The following is the process that the participants went through the experiment. So after having received the viral lessons, all the groups participated in a phase called baseline, in which they went through five conditions called normal instrument conditions repeated five times. In each of these same conditions, participants were asked to perform two full bow exercises. In total, they performed 10 full bow exercises on the baseline. Then after a 5-minute break, the participants entered in the acquisition phase. First, the participants went into another normal instrument condition. Then, and always in the same order, they participated in a kinematic instrument condition. So in this condition, the control group was asked to perform a full bow exercise, focusing on trying to play with the bow as straight as possible and not paying as much attention to the resulting sound. On the other hand, the feedback group received real-time visual feedback about the position of the bow. After that, in the sound quality instrument condition, the control group was asked to pay attention when performing the full bow exercises on the dynamics and stability of the tone. On the other hand, the feedback group was offered visual feedback of the sound quality generated in real time. This sequence of three conditions is repeated five times during the acquisition phase, leading to a total of 30 tries. Finally, and after another 5 minutes of rest, the participants went to the transfer phase, where they repeated another 10 trials under the same condition as in the baseline condition. Once all the phases were finished, the control group participated in an extra session where they were shown and were able to use the technologies that they had not previously used. Once they had interacted with them, they had, like the rest of the groups, to answer a questionnaire about their opinions regarding the technology they used. So the main kinematic feature that we calculated from the Kinect was bow skewness, since it was the one that most affected participants to pay attention. The angle of skewness has a value of zero when the bow is completely perpendicular to the strings. So for each attempt, we compute the descriptor as the mean absolute error of the skewness angle referenced to zero. On the other hand, we compute the sound quality features in a similar way. We calculate them as the standard deviation of distance and power in dBs for dynamic stability and as the fundamental frequency in hertz for the pitch stability. Note that in this definition, the descriptors, a lower value indicates more stability, while a higher value indicates less stability. Okay, now let's go to the results. Here in this image, we have the results of the analysis. The CG in the left part of the image corresponds to the control group, the EG corresponds to the expert group, and the FG to the feedback group. Each bar represents one of the conditions of the experiment, and their head represents the average value of the descriptor of the condition. So we found that experts showed lower values of OSQ-ness than beginners in a significant way. This means that their angle was closer to zero, which means that their bow was closer to be perpendicular than beginners. Experts also showed significantly lower values than beginners in the sound quality analysis, both in dynamic stability and pitch stability. In the case thus, that their sounds were more stable than test. So if we look at the results of the control group, the CG, we can see how the control group significantly improved the results in pitch stability at the end of the experiment in the transfer condition. However, they did not improve the results neither in straight bowing nor in dynamic stability. This may indicate that improvement in pitch stability is much easier to achieve than the other two. On the other hand, the FG at the end of the experiment improved not only pitch stability, but also in dynamic stability, highlighting an improvement effect that could be due to feedback. However, no significant improvements were found for straight bowing in the kinematic analysis. This could mean two things: that straight bowing is a complex skill and improving it requires much more time than the one used in this experiment, or that the feedback offered has not exerted any kind of influence on our participants. To explore more of these possibilities, we decided to study the behavior of the participants during the acquisition phase. We found, in fact, how the FG improved straight bow at acquisition when receiving real-time feedback. However, real-time feedback seemed to deteriorate the quality of the sound of the beginners while receiving it. So the reason probably lies in the fact that we are using visual feedback, which competes with the attention devoted to their brain. This increases the working load of participants while doing the task. But the question remains, why is the response of the participants different for each type of feedback? We have hypothesized that the type of feedback has exerted an influence. The kinematic feedback offered information about how to improve your results. You can clearly see the trajectory you are following. The sound quality feedback, on the other hand, offered somehow binary information, like right or wrong, without offering information about how to improve the previous sound. However, this did not seem to exert a negative effect on the performance of the feedback group. Since, as we can see in the NIC, they improve the results anyway when withdrawing the feedback. At the same time, they retain those good results also in straight bowing in the acquisition NIC condition. On the other hand, we found an interesting trend in the control group. They worsened the results in pitch stability at the KIC and tended to improve the results in bowing skewness and sound quality in the acquisition sound quality instrument condition. Remember that in the acquisition KIC condition, participants from the control group were asked to focus their attention on playing with a straight bow and ignore sound quality, while in the acquisition SQIC, in generating a good sound. This may look contradictory. However, it is possible that focusing in a good sound instead of their own body movement places their attention in an external locus of focus, the sound generated, instead of in an internal one, the body movements. As we know from the work of Gabriel Wood, an external locus of focus could enhance motor learning, while an internal one tends to deteriorate. However, the improvement found was not transferred to any other conditions or exerted any kind of influence in the dynamic study. And finally, to check out to what extent technology could have affected our results depending on the participants, we calculated the relative differences between transfer and baseline in each group of beginners. We found significant differences only for dynamic stability, where the group that received feedback showed a clear improvement in the results than the control. In the results of the questionnaires, we did not find many differences between participants in general. All groups highly valued the technologies used in the experiment, regardless of the group. There were differences regarding what each participant believed they had improved the most during the session. In general, most of them considered that what had improved the most had been the movement and the kinematics of the exercise, including the expert group. Regarding the problems encountered, it is worth noting that the group that received the technologies showed, as we have already shown in the behavioral results, that they had trouble playing while looking at the feedback. However, the expert group or the control group did not appear to show the paper. So some of the main contributions of the part of the thesis are to show the relevance of some audio descriptors that can help us to characterize the expert performance, such as dynamic stability and pitch stability. We have also found how a kinematic descriptor, such as voice skillness, can serve us in the same way. At the same time, we have shown how these descriptors allow us to track the learning process of beginner violinists. But not only that, because thanks to these descriptors, we can have objective measurements of the improvement of participants, allowing us to explore the effects of augmented feedback and attentive processes in performance. We have to recognize, however, that despite participants perform a relatively simple task, we are using a very reductionist approach. And we are aware that there are many more features and variables that may be interacting and would contribute more clarity to the interpretation of our data. That's also the reason that we wanted to pave the way for future research that want to find those more relevant features by sharing various data sets with all the raw data acquired. A data set with the raw data of audio and EEG activity of 18 violin beginners learning football movements during 20 trials, and the same type of activity of 7 violinists. We'll also share in GitHub the code of the analysis to analyze the EEG and audio activity. And finally, we'll also share the data of this last experiment, which was the raw data of audio and all the kinematic pitches, which is not only skewness, but also tilt, inclination, posture of 57 violinist beginners learning full bow movements during a total of 55 cycles. Also, the same type of activity of 15 violinists. And we also have another data set in Zenodo with already pre-processed data and the codes used to analyze kinematics and sound quality. So now let's move to the second part of this thesis called intonation in the violin. So making music is an activity that requires a strong coupling between the auditory and motor system. This coupling gives auditory feedback an important role to establish the required associations between action and perception, and thus enable musical learning. This is consistent with a wide amount of literature that shows how auditory feedback seems to be more important for beginners than for expert musicians. We know that removing auditory feedback in an expert performance with the piano, for example, does not have a negative effect on music. This suggests that musicians have a strong association between actions and their expected auditory consequences, that is, strong internal models. However, unlike the piano and other key to fretted instruments like the guitar, pitch control in the violin is continuous, and thus movement has to be much more precise. This makes music production and intonation monitoring with those instruments much more dependent on auditory feedback. Relying only on the auditory feedback of their actions to find the correct note is a daunting task for a lot of people. But why? This is the main question of this part of the thesis. If we understand bad intonation as the product of a quick internal model that can't anticipate the consequences of its own action, and thus making beginners unable to detect when they are out of tune, which is the best way to strengthen this model? How can the collaboration between musical technologies, pedagogy, and psychological paradigms help us in this process? This is what we will explore in the first experiment on this part, while in the second experiment, we will explore which are the electrophysiological correlates of those internal models that allow us to differentiate between experts and say us how they detect and correct intonation errors in the performance. So the first experiment of this part is called Effects of Visual and Auditory Feedback in Violin and Singing Voice Pitch Matching Tasks, and has already been published in Frontiers in Psychology. So the main aim of this work was, as the title says, to compare the effects of visual feedback in the form of real-time pitch visualizations compared with auditory feedback. When we go to the literature, we found that most of the studies which have studied the effects of visual feedback tend to report positive results. The contrast with the variety of results found in those studies does have explored the use of auditory feedback, which has been not very successful. So all these studies, however, they have very clear limitations in relation to what we have been showing so far in the first chapter of the thesis. First, not all of them included retention phases, and also there is no common methodology to help compare results between experiments. This last problem can be solved following the methodological procedures for doing research in singing skills proposed during the Seattle International Singing Research Symposium. Recently, 2 months after the publication of my manuscript, Bernin, Fordreser, and Demolest also published work comparing the effects of visual and auditory feedback self-directed learning using the same methodological procedures. In their results, they found a positive effect of the combination of visual and auditory feedback. However, no positive effect was found for auditory feedback. However, there is still a common limitation in all of those previous studies, including this previous one. Most of them tended to use sounds with a different time timbre than the voice as augmented auditory feedback. And this can be troublesome because, as Hutchinson Perez reported, timbre is not perceptually independent of pitch, and participants of their experiment dramatically improved their intonation skills when the tone to be imitated had a timbre as identical as possible to that of the instrument they were using. So in their experiment, participants had to match a single pitch, either using the voice or a slider. Inspired by their work, we designed a new experiment where we replaced the slider and used a violin. We will also explore the effects of visual and auditory feedback in learning, but we will use auditory feedback with a similar timbre as identical as possible to that of the instrument being used. That is, participants will try to match a pitch with the violin, hearing auditory feedback in the form of real violin sounds, and participants will try to match a pitch with the voice while hearing a real human voice. So for that purpose, we have readapted for the context of the Termi project, the system designed by Major et al., which offers real-time feedback of the pitch sung by the participants while offering at the same time a yellow mark indicating the location of the target note. So beginners were divided into three groups. A feedback group that received real-time visual feedback of the produced pitch composed by 15 participants. The equal timbre group received auditory feedback in the form of violin or human voice, and the control group just received auditory feedback in the form of a synthesizer sound. Finally, we also included an expert group for comparison purposes. So first, like before, the participants went through the baseline phase to check their intonation levels. After that, they started the acquisition phase, which was composed of three different conditions, the pre-8, D8, and the post-8 condition. And finally, participants did a transfer phase, which was equal to the baseline. So in the baseline, all the different groups of participants alternated between the voice and the violin in a random manner. They listened to a synthesized pure tone with one of the 5 notes used in the experiment. And after that, they tried to match the note with the violin or with the voice. And finally, they had a second opportunity with the same note. In the acquisition phase, participants first started the acquisition pre-8 condition. This condition was exactly equal to the condition we have seen in the baseline. However, after this condition, they started the acquisition 8 condition. In this condition, the control group had an infinite number of opportunities to match the same previous pitch, thus ensuring that the lack of attempts is not the cause of its bad intonation. On the other hand, the equal timbre group could hear a real human voice singing the previous pitch and also had an infinite number of attempts. In a random way, participants alternated between voice and the violin. The main difference was that the equal timbre group now could hear to the recordings of a real violin sound performing the same note. Finally, the feedback group received real-time visual feedback with the corresponding note appearing on the screen as target. So after the acquisition A, the feedback was closed, and all groups entered in acquisition post A. Listened again to the same stimulus, this time in the form of a synthesized pure tone, and had to try to get it right again. Then the acquisition pre-8 started again for a different note. So after the acquisition phase, participants started the transfer phase, which was the same as the baseline. So now let's go to the results. So in this plot, we have the violin results on the left and the voice results on the right. The ETG is the equal timbre group, the CG, the control group, and the FG, the feedback group. Above, we can see the accuracy results and below, the number of correct notes. Each bar represents each condition of the experiment with the absence of acquisition A. As expected, we can see how the accuracy of the experts was better than that of the rest of the beginners. However, we can also see differences in the behavior of the participants. We can see how the accuracy with the violin tended to be better than the accuracy with the voice. This somehow replicates some of the results of the Hutchins and Perez experiment, however, with much bigger errors. One possibility is that the violin sound is timbrically close to the sinusoidal pure tone used. Also, if we take a look at the results of the participants at the transfer phase, we can observe that only the FG improved the results at the transfer phase. None of the other groups improved the results at the end of the experiments, neither in the number of correct notes nor in accuracy. However, we can see how feedback exerted a different influence on each group. So for example, we did not find improvement in the control group in the post-aid condition. This suggests that the main problem of the participant finding the note was not due to a lack of attempts. And in the other hand, we found how auditory feedback exerted a different influence on the voice than on the violin. We did not find significant differences between the results of the ETG at post-aid compared with those of the experts of the feedback group at the voice condition. That is, auditory feedback clearly helped them in the results with the voice. We can also see an improvement in violin intonation after auditory feedback in the post-aid condition, but it was not so relevant. We can gain more insight into our results by taking a look at the behavior of the participants during the acquisition aid condition. So in the acquisition aid condition, participants from the ETG tended to spend less time finding the correct note with the voice than with the violin, even less than the feedback loop. In addition, they also requested fewer times the auditory feedback. Similar results were also reported by Hutchins and Perez. So in their experiments, participants also required less time and fewer attempts when imitating their own voice than in the rest of condition. We consider that timbre is not the only cause behind those results, as Hutchins and Perez proposed. We hypothesize that there is a human voice advantage that we should consider, because humans, like some other animals, we have the ability to imitate arbitrary sounds through what has come to be called auditory guided vocal learning. This effect will be mediated by mirror neurons, which goal allow an immediate reproduction of any vocal command that could be executed immediately. Even more, if we take into consideration our bigger familiarity with human voices than with other sounds. This could mean that participants are actually being able to match the correct pitch with the voice through some kind of implicit imitation skills. However, despite being able to match the pitch after receiving auditory feedback with a similar timbre, that did not allow them to improve the results in the rest of the conditions. So we have thought of two possible reasons. First, although participants from the ETG were able to perform the task correctly in the acquisition post-aid, the level of confidence of their chosen answers could have been less than those of the FG, impairing them to learn the mapping between one timbre and the other. It is also possible that both the objective visual measures and the experience of exploring the pitch space with their voice in an explicit manner help participants to understand how they got where they wanted to go, strengthening their schema and favoring retention. So future research could actually address this issue by offering a binary feedback, right or wrong, to some participants in the equal timbre group after their chosen answers. So in this work, we have also contributed to the comparison of the effects of auditory and visual feedback in learning intonation abilities. We have also explored the relationship of intonation abilities both with the violin and with the voice. We have also revalidated the importance of music intonation technologies, not only in learning, but also for the research in music psychology. So here we have contributed with the creation of two datasets in Senodo, which contain the raw data of the produced violin and voice sounds of 47 non-musicians in a pitch matching task, and also the data of 15 experts. We have also another data set in Senodo, which contains the pre-processed data and the code used to analyze it. So now let's talk about the last experiment of this part, online tone manipulation in violin performance. And as we said before, the main of this work is to study the electrophysiological correlates of error correct detection and correction in expert string players. So one of the most common electrophysiological correlates of errors of performance is the error-related negativity, or the ERN. This negativity has a frontocentral topography and is usually elicited after errors in discrete response tasks. This negativity was also found in self-generated errors on the piano in the work of Perojo Ruiz, which they termed the pre-ERN because it was elicited around 50 milliseconds before the onset of the ground note. A year later, Matlock et al. Found how externally manipulating the pitch of some notes during a piano performance elicited in participants a negativity peaking around 240 milliseconds after the onset of the note. This negativity is termed the feedback ERN or FERN. So the main difference between the FERN and the pre-ERN is that the FERN is thought to be generated by the auditory feedback of the incorrect note produced. However, the pre-ERN is usually elicited even before the commission of the error, because it is produced by an efference copy of the expected outcomes of the ballistic movement generated by an inverse model. As we said before, the violin is much more dependent on auditory feedback than the piano. This means that participants are continuously regulating and correcting their intonation through auditory feedback. Also, the performance in the piano could be somehow closer to ballistic movements, where the feedback can be right or wrong, eliciting only reward errors. However, performance with the violin includes also continuous movements and correction, which may elicit sensory prediction errors. We know that each type of error engages different systems in the brain. Reward errors, for example, are thought to be dependent on a loop between basal ganglia, the thalamus, and the medial frontal cortex. It is possible that both the pre-ERN and the FERN are electrophysiological correlates of such reward errors. On the other hand, sensory prediction errors usually involve the cerebellum and the posterior parietal cortex. Recently, Segado et al. Studied the fMRI of cello players, ignoring note manipulations and correcting them. Consistent with this interpretation we just made, they found that corrective movements in the cello engaged additional activity in the intraparietal sulcus and the supramarginal gyrus. But what kind of correlates do sensory prediction errors may have in the EEG signal? So the ERN tends to be followed by a positivity called the P300. Some studies have suggested that the P300 could be involved in sensory prediction errors. The P300 can be interpreted as two different components, an earlier one with a frontal distribution, the P3 gate, and a more posterior one that occurs later, the P3B. Some studies have suggested that the P3B or parietal P300 is involved in adapting response strategies following an error and with the updating of an internal model of the environment. On the other hand, some studies which have studied the effects of corrective movements in visual tracking tasks, like Grigolson et al., have reported a parietal negativity peaking around 360 milliseconds. According to the authors, high-level information, reward errors, the ERN, was communicated to the posterior parietal cortex once evaluated by the medial frontal cortex for the adaptive modification of behavior. So for the purposes of this experiment, our aim is to investigate the neural correlates of error detection and correction, not only in an active condition, that is playing instrument, but also in a passive or replayed condition, where participants were listening to the recording of their own performance. Additionally, we have designed a setup that allow us to manipulate in real time some of the notes of the performance. So here in the right part of this image, we can see how we asked participants to hold the violin between their legs like a cello. They also had to wear earbuds and earmuffs to avoid them listening to external sounds and the real sound of the violin, because they were listening by themselves by the microphone. We can also see here in the top left an example of one possible score they had to replicate, where one of the notes of the melody was randomly manipulated by us by 50 cents up or down. Apart from the open string note, which is always the first note, we can see three different types of notes here, which are non-manipulated, the manipulated, and the post-manipulated. And below, we have the three different conditions of the experiment. The reference condition, where participants heard the reference melody, the active condition, where participants played the melody, and finally, the replayed condition where participants could listen to the replay of the melody. So now we go to the behavioral results. So we found, as expected, how participants tended to increase the percentage of notes followed by corrective movements together with their magnitude, depending on the absolute error committed. We also found how the absolute error after the corrective movements tended to be around 20 cents and was not dependent on the magnitude of the error. Finally, participants started the corrective movements around 300 milliseconds and ended them around 800 milliseconds, regardless of the produced error. We also did not find any significant difference in behavior between manipulated, non-manipulated, and post-manipulated notes. So now in the electrophysiological results, we decided to remove from the analysis those notes with an error between 15 and 30 cents and considered as mistuned all the notes above 30 cents. We could see how self-generated errors, non-manipulated, elicited an FERN instead of a pre-ERN, as in previous literature. This was expected because the pre-ERN is elicited in fast tasks, and the tempo of our melodies was very slow. Also, as we said, the violin depends more on auditory feedback than the piano. So we found no significant difference in a precedent analysis between the manipulated, post-manipulated or the non-manipulated errors, neither in the active nor in the passive condition. And we decided from this point to average them into a single tuned and mistuned category. So in the active condition, we found activity related to an FPRN peaking at 240 milliseconds with a frontal central distribution. It was followed by another parietal, another negativity peaking at 280 milliseconds that we termed the N280. And this histography was center and right, contralateral to the left arm of the participant. The fact that it seems to coincide with the average time at which participants started the correction makes us think that it may be a motor-related cortical potential related to the corrective movement. Following that, we also found a parietal negativity maximum at PC and maximum at 340 milliseconds that we term the N34. This negativity looks similar both in topography and latency to that one reported in the experiment of Pligorson and Conroy with visual tracking tasks. According to them, this negativity could be the electrophysiological correlate of sensory prediction errors. And following the parietal negativity, we found a frontal positivity that could be related to the P3A, which was followed by a central positivity that could be related to the P3B. It is important to note that the latencies of the P3A and P3B do not tend to show up that late, like in this experiment. Here, they were preceded by an N280 and an N340 component, which to our knowledge has never been reported in discrete tasks without corrective movements. So in the replay condition, we found the same components as in the active condition. Although their amplitude seemed diminished, the main difference was the lack of a P3B component. This would be expected when we take into account that participants were not told to detect their errors in the replay condition. So we also computed the event-related spectral perturbations, and we found beta activity in tuned condition appeared after the onset of the node, which could be related to the known beta rebound. We also found how this beta rebound increased its decreased its amplitude in the mistuned condition, and as can be seen also here in the mistuned minus tuned condition. So the topography of the beta rebound was contralateral to the finger of the left arm and seem to coincide in latency with the end of the corrective movement. We also found how mistuned nodes provoked an increase in set activity just after the onset of the mistuned nodes. And this topography appeared in midfrontal electrodes and might be related to the well-known midfrontal theta activity. We did not find any beta effect in the replay condition. However, we also found some midfrontal theta activity occurring after the onset of mistuned nodes. However, it was not significant. Here we can see the interaction between condition, active replay, and mistuned and condition, mistuned and tuned. So, So the main difference was found in the midfrontal theta activity, the beta rebound, and the P3. We can say that in our main findings, we have found an FPRN in both conditions, an N280 and an N340, which together could be related both to the corrective movements or the processing of sensory prediction errors, a P3A, which was followed by a P3B absent in the replay condition. We also found a beta rebound absent in the replay condition and an midfrontal theta much higher inactive than in replay. We can gain more insight into these components by studying their behavior with the magnitude of the error. So we found that the amplitude of the FERN was related to the magnitude of the errors, both in the active and replay condition. However, for the rest of the components, with the exception of the P3A, the amplitudes were modulated by the magnitude of the error only in the active condition. We also studied the effect of the latency of the corrective movements in the components. So we separated the trials into fast corrections before 250 milliseconds, medium corrections between 250 and 350 milliseconds, and slow corrections, slower than 350 milliseconds. And we found that the latency of the components was not modulated by the onset of corrective movements. However, we found that fast corrections tended to elicit greater amplitudes of the FERN only in the active conditions. On the other hand, slower amplitudes tended to elicit greater amplitudes in the rest of the components. Again, this was only in the active condition. It is possible that greater errors elicit bigger FERN amplitudes, which in turn leads to faster correction. However, as we already showed in the behavioral results, the onset of corrective movements did not depend on the magnitude of the produced error. It is possible that we are being testimonies of the exchange between different error monitoring systems. Let's say a fast system mediated by the medial frontal cortex and reward errors, and a slow system mediated by posterior parietal cortex and sensory processing errors. However, it is still possible that the activity we see may be related to motor-related potentials of the corrective neurons. So for that reason, we consider that it's important in future research to add a condition without corrective movements. Nevertheless, recently, Melanie Segado, in her PhD thesis, reports an unpublished experiment of PEG with the cello and reported no significant difference between a condition with corrective movements and a condition with them. So, summarizing, in this work, we have elaborated and designed a setup that has allowed us to collect and synchronize the activity and audio of string players at the same time that we could manipulate the pitch of some of the performance of circular time. So we have used that setup to study the EEG correlates of music performance with a blended instrument, which provides new perspective to study the error monitoring processes of musical performance. And finally, we are also sharing all of our data in a Zenodo dataset. We share all of our real EEG and audio data of 15 violin cello experts performing melodies. And we have also shared the code used to analyze the results and the code of the online tone manipulation system and all the setup. Okay. So now in the final conclusions, we are going to recapitulate the different objectives of the thesis. So the first objective was to develop a methodological framework for doing research with educational technologies, which is included in the second chapter of the thesis. The second objective was to find relevant features to distinguish between the expert and beginner performance. And in the sound motion part of the thesis, we have shown two experiments that allowed us to explore some quality descriptors for that purpose, such as dynamic stability and pitch stability. In the second experiment, we also found using optical motion capture techniques how bow skewness allowed us to distinguish between beginners and experts. And finally, we also collected from experts some descriptors which, based on the existing literature, can help us distinguish experts from beginners based solely on their EEG activity. So the third objective was to use those features to track the learning process of participants. We also did that in the sound and motion part of the thesis. In the first two experiments, where participants were learning to produce full bow exercise. And in the fourth, the objective was to evaluate the effects of feedback technologies during the process of learning. We did that again in the sound and motion part of the thesis, but also in the first experiment of the intonation part of the thesis, where we also evaluated the effects of real-time visual feedback for intonation, both the violin and with the voice. And the fifth objective of this thesis was to use music technologies to study neurophysiological correlates of learning, error monitoring, and error correction. We have done that in the last experiment, where in collaboration with the Brain Lab, we have elaborated and designed a setup that has allowed us to collect and synchronize the EEG activity and audio of a string player at the same time that we could manipulate the pitch of some of the performance notes in real time. We also have used that setup to study the EEG correlates of music performance with a friendless instrument, which provides new perspective to study the error monitoring processes in music performance. So in this process, we have created and generated data sets containing raw data of the audio of violin beginners learning to play, also kinematic features obtained through motion capture technologies, intonation skills, and also EEG activity of both experts and beginner participants. During this year, this thesis has also been the source of 5 publications and 1 in preparation. 2 were published in conferences and 3 of them were in journals. And finally, we have shown how with relatively simple methods, we can evaluate the first steps of learning complex skills, such as playing the violin and learn about the effects of feedback there. In addition, the inclusion of electroencephalography techniques in experiments or the extension of their use to more ecological context to which we are normally accustomed can offer us a broader perspective on how to interpret the different learning processes that our participants may be subjected to and how the feedback may be affecting them. So these technologies have also the potential to become useful tools that students can use to assess the quality of their performance from different points of view and in turn even compare it numerically with that of their teachers and peers. Also, in this pandemic context, the proliferation of online classes and courses and the physical separation between students and teachers have accelerated a process that has been brewing for many years in which this type of technologies will play an undeniable role. The incorporation of them in this online context will allow the availability of important sources of data as we have never had before. All in all, the design and implementation of these technologies will help us to learn to better characterize the different learning processes and answer some of the questions with which we began this thesis, such as what is that distinguishes the expert performance from the amateur? For now, we only know that only a truly multidisciplinary enterprise involving psychologists, neuroscientists, engineers, and pedagogues can lead us to transcend our understanding of musical learning in all its deepest essence and facets. And lastly, also offer light and better answers to all the questions in this thesis that are still open. So to end, I want to thank each and every one of the people who have made it possible for this thesis, even those who are no longer with us, but were very supportive during my first year, like Agustin. And I know that I have not been able to include as many as I wanted, but above all, I want to dedicate this thesis to my father, who passed away last year. And my father dedicated his entire life to scientific research, and even in his last days in the hospital were spent answering his students. So I gave him the promise that he will be with me on the day of my thesis presentation, and that's how it had to be, because in many different ways, I know he's here with me. So thank you very much.